all the social flies. Is that good social?
Maybe. It's trying. There we go. Thank you for joining Auto Network Reports. I'm your host, Roosevelt, and we will take you inside the auto industry like never before. And when I say we, I mean Mr. Greg Morrison, Bumper to Bumper TV out of Atlanta, Georgia. Mr. Frank Washington, AboutThatCar.com out of Detroit. And our very special guest, Nikita Kayashi from Downey Nissan in Los Angeles, California. We've been trying to get somebody on for quite a while from the auto dealership side, and Nissan helped me get Nikita on, and she's one of the top salespeople, until she was promoted to the general sales manager at Downey Nissan. Before we get into Nikita's presentation, I'd like to cover a couple of things. One, we have a couple of recalls. Looks like Toyota is having some problems with have about 28,600 2018 CHRs. The electronic parking brake may not operate properly. Obviously, that could pose a big problem. They have 39,900 2012 through 2015 Prius plug-in hybrids. And the hybrid fuse may malfunction, which means the warning lights will illuminate all over the place. But it also could shut down the hybrid system itself, which means a loss of some of the power. And we all know that's not a good thing either. One other thing, where is it on my list of things here? We have I guess you would call it a promotion. Felix Brodigam is the new chief of marketing for Jaguar Land Rover. That's effective January the 1st. And he was with Porsche. He was the vice president of Europe. Now he's the chief marketing officer for Jaguar Land Rover. So hopefully we will get to see Felix on the road sometime, whenever we go out on a Jaguar Land Rover event. So that's enough of that good stuff. Why don't we get right into our special guest? Because I know she has, her time is busy. You should have seen her in the green room waving all over the place, directing traffic, telling people what to do. She's a busy, busy lady. And Nikita came to me, like I said, from Nissan. I read an article about how well she was doing with Downey Nissan. And as a matter of fact, Downey Nissan in their region is the number one Nissan dealer for the Hispanic market, even though, as we can see, Nikita is not Hispanic. So that's going to be interesting to see how she managed to pull that off. But Nikita, why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself, how you got involved in the auto industry, and what's happening with you at Downey Nissan?
So again, thank you so much for having me on here. I started in about 2008. I started working for Nissan where I lived in San Diego as receptionist, and then went into sales, internet sales, finance, and then into desking, and then now general sales manager. I did move up to LA. I have to say, throughout my career, I have been really fortunate to work with wonderful people. So that's half the battle, is finding a really good home wherever you go. So in that aspect, I'm really lucky. I've been here in about Downey for about a year, and I work for definitely one of the best owners, I would say, in the whole industry. And that's part of it. He's created such a wonderful environment for not just me, but for anyone to work in.
Now, what were you doing before you got in the auto industry?
I was in school, and then I came home. From school, I went to UNLV, and then I came home, and I have an 11-year-old, so I had my daughter pretty young, and just kind of started working part-time, and didn't really think it was going to be anything other than, okay, I'll just do a part-time reception, I'll take this part-time reception job, and then it turned into a career for me, so it was unexpected, but it really worked out.
Now, on this show, we talk a lot about millennials, And as you can see, the three of us are nowhere near millennial. We have we have left that way, way back. We have a dusty trail. And in the article, it said you were 31.
Yes.
And you have about 40 plus salespeople, I guess, that you oversee or manage, and all of them are younger than you.
Yeah, I would say the average age is about 26 of my employees.
So you're the old lady on the floor.
I am.
Now, so, as you well know, in a dealership, you have all different age groups coming in to buy an automobile. What is it? How would you all relate? First of all, how do you relate to your younger salespeople, and how do you train them and yourself, or how are you trained to relate to older people like me, Greg, and Frank?
Well, I would say with my staff, and it's kind of, I do the same process with my younger and older staff. I think it just kind of is more about getting everybody involved and making them all feel comfortable. But we make learning fun. Like, we don't just rely on what the manufacturer provides for training. We do a lot of games. We even do like crosswords to kill time. We have an online class, and then of course, just, you know, walk arounds and stuff. So we've taken a different approach to learning. So everybody learns, right? And everybody feels comfortable. Well, we do incorporate technology as well.
I won't hog all the questions. You guys can jump in anytime. So,
well, Nikita, Greg Morrison, can you hear me?
Yes, I can. Thank you.
I guess the one question that comes to my mind, what is the difference when, say, a millennial comes in looking for a vehicle versus someone like myself, who is part of whatever generation they want to call us, not the greatest generation, but what is the difference, you know, between when a boomer comes in versus a millennial coming in looking for a car? How's the, is the approach different, or is it the same approach?
You know, I think I would say different, because the, when they come in, when millennials do come in, most of them come in online. You know, they've already put in a lead. They've already have a lot of their pricing and legwork done up front, versus, you know, when we do have people that are a little bit older, they come in and they kind of go dealer to dealer and start from scratch, get their pricing, and then come back. Whereas millennials have done almost everything online.
Once you get past that, okay, I've done the online, I've done the research for the vehicle, I've done my numbers. How long is the average transaction period to get in, start the deal, get the deal, get the person in the car driving off the parking lot? How many hours does that take?
You know what? I would say finance, you know, depending on how much paperwork they have, if it's complicated or not, I would say about 45 minutes, and then, you know, 15 minutes to deliver. So it's about an hour process.
You are setting a land speed record there.
Yeah. And now, again, it is case by case, because sometimes I think what takes the longest is if there's a customer in front of them or not. Now, we do have five finance managers working, so that kind of helps to move things along. But if, you know, if we've gone through, most of the waiting time is just getting approvals and agreeing on numbers. The easy part is just going in and signing.
I mention it because I have a daughter who's technically a millennial, and she recently went to renew her lease on her vehicle. And she spent 6.5-7 hours there and was so frustrated at the end of the process, she almost walked off away from the deal. What does that say about where the dealership is that she was at and should be heading, at least from your perspective?
Well, I think if she's just going to renew her lease, it probably, in my opinion, shouldn't have taken that long. It should have been a more streamlined process. I would say maybe just miscommunication. That's probably what took so long, because once you get in to finance, even if there's a customer in front of you, it shouldn't take more than, you know, an hour, 45 minutes after everything's done.
Yeah. And I'm just wondering, because I'm sure that the buying process is changing continually. And there are some folks who come in with everything ready to go. They just want to get in the car and go. Do you folks take any time to say, okay, wait a minute, before you go, let me show you some of the features of this car. Let me talk to you about some of the driver's
safety. Oh, yeah. No, absolutely. We do, definitely. We have a full, and Nissan does a digital delivery. It's NCAR. So there's a whole checklist that you have to go through. And then, you know, we are asked about the delivery process in our KPI, which is now replaced CSI, the key performance indicator. So that's very important to us. So we will slow customers down. And if they are really truly in a rush, we'll also offer a time to deliver the car.
Okay.
It's Frank in Detroit. I'm just interested, you know, on the one hand, you haven't been in the business that long. But on the other hand, given the advent of technology, the way people are changing, the information available, you know, was it 7-8 years that you've been there? That's a long time, you know, in terms of how fast things are moving. And I guess the question is, how has it changed, you know, in the time that you've been there? What have you seen change?
Well, you know, the things that I've seen change is, well, DealerTrack. So when I came in into finance, DealerTrack was already in place. So I couldn't even imagine, you know, what it would be like without DealerTrack, because that's half the battle, just getting all the information securely over to the lender. The things that I have seen change is definitely more technology driven. The cars are more technology. The delivery process now involves technology. The credit apps are all digital. So everything, all the paperwork has gone digital. The finance paperwork too, we went from printing all the documents to now we do them on the DocuPad, and that's all digital. So funding has become digital. That's where I've seen a big change.
Well, you know, it seems to me, or at least from what you're saying, the backside of this is training, you know, in terms of your salespeople as well as you have to be trained and then sometimes retrained. When I say retrain, I'm not talking about necessarily the same thing, but new applications.
Oh yeah, definitely. Like
a constant learning that you have to do.
Yes, and a lot of it too. So, and I'll show you. Every salesperson has an iPad. We give every salesperson has their individual iPad. Everything is done on here, from the delivery to the credit app, and then we have different apps that we're trying. So right now, I'm going to start piloting another app where we can actually even send, so the salesperson doesn't have to come here to get a printout. I can digitally send them a printout onto their iPad. So I look for ways, different ways to like use technology to kind of streamline the process so the customer isn't waiting as long.
Okay.
Nikita, if I read correctly, your dealership is primarily commission, if I'm not mistaken.
Yes.
And being in sales, commission is probably one of the toughest things to be on in terms of having some kind of stable income and you are a single parent. Why did you choose to go into auto sales on a commission basis?
You know, I just kind of had faith in myself. I just took a risk, and my family had advised me against it, and I wanted to give it a try. I didn't really have anything to lose, right? If it doesn't work out, I'll find something else to fall back on. But if you have a good process and you're consistent, you'll find a way to make it work month in, month out, just like everybody else does. Everyone that's successful, I have salespeople here that have been salespeople for years and years, and they do very well. And then I have new salespeople who came from, you know, different, and people that come from like cell phone companies and whatnot, and they, you know, were doing commission on maybe a smaller scale, and now, and they've done really well here too. So it's just having faith in yourself and not being scared of commission.
What's the toughest thing that you found being a female on the sales floor?
Well, being a female, I think more even being a mom, it was the schedule was an adjustment, because I think we're so programmed to think 9 to 5, 9 to 5, 9 to 5. But, you know, that's not the case. It's just, you will have time off. It's just different time off. And so what if you give up an extra 20 hours a week? You know, you're earning extra income for your family. So it's just resetting your mentality and getting away from the, oh, 9 to 5 is the way to go.
Nikita, we've heard these crazy stories over the years of some of the antics that have happened in dealerships with salespeople. From your perspective, what is the strangest or most unusual sale experience that you've had to encounter from your side of the table?
That's a very odd question, because I desk so many deals that I don't even really remember an odd sales experience. You know, you always have one or two strange customers, but I really couldn't tell you off the top of my head.
So no one came in wanting a pink car with green interior and blacked out wheels or anything like that?
No, not that I can recall. I mean, we definitely have, you know, we have kids that come in and they want to get the GTR, and we've had teenagers come in and actually buy a GTR, and you'd be surprised, right? But no strange requests that I can think of. I'm trying to think. Nothing crazy that I can think of.
If you don't mind, Nikita, take a minute or so and tell us about your sales training process at Downey. What did they do to help you become successful?
So our sales training process at Downey, so in addition to the sales training that Nissan provides, we also have the teams divided, and then each team has their manager that gives them, you know, it's there to help them any step of the way. If they're struggling with a customer, the assistant sales manager step in. So they provide that. We do, we make product training fun. So like I mentioned before, we play a lot of games, and I think it helps people because it's competitive, but it's fun, and it helps them remember, you know, their product better than just reading it online, right? So that we have a classroom set up, and then we provide, again, training on all of our iPad apps. We have provide training on our, you know, step-by-step process, greeting the customer, all of that. So it's definitely a very welcoming learning environment.
Are you bilingual by chance, or trilingual, or anything like that?
I am bilingual. I speak Nepali, which, you know, I never really use it at work. I wish I could. At this point, I might trade it in for Spanish if I could.
Since you mentioned the Hispanic market, and the article was talking about how Downey Nissan has been very successful in selling to Hispanics, what's the reason for that?
Part of it is the location too. We are in the street that we're on, Firestone. It crosses three cities, and a lot of the city, it's primarily Hispanic area that we are in. Also a lot of my sales staff, and not even by virtue of us going on recruiting, that have just come in to apply. They are younger. They're all bilingual. So it kind of just came together.
Do you notice any cultural differences among your customers in terms of how they approach the car buying process, you know, especially cultural and age difference, how they approach the process?
You know, I will say here in this area, there is a lot of brand loyalty to Nissan. So it's almost less brand cross-shopping and maybe like cross-shopping dealers. So that's one thing I've noticed. A lot of our customers, yeah, I would say 50-50, the millennials all, again, they do the online, but we do have customers that prefer to walk in, and we have a lot of repeat customers that prefer to walk in and work with the salesperson that they're used to working with. They feel very comfortable, I think, speaking in Spanish. They feel more comfortable speaking in Spanish and doing the whole transaction in Spanish from top to bottom.
Yeah, if I'm not mistaken, I think it's either Nissan or Toyota that's number one in the Hispanic market when it comes to purchasing an automobile. Nikita, final question, unless the other guys have something to ask. What, let's say if I'm a person, regardless of the age or the sex or the gender, and I'm interested in getting into auto sales, what should I be looking for?
Dealership reputation. So first thing is, you know, dealership reputation is everything, right? Because where you worked will always be on your resume, and the next place you go to is going to look at who you worked for. So that's number one. And then just don't be scared, you know, especially there's so many women that are scared. Don't be scared. What are you scared of? That you might have to work weekends? Who cares? You'll be able to provide a good living for yourself and your family. And learn a trade. It's pretty cool. You know, we customers leave here, they're so happy to have a car, and it's really, I'm happy when they're happy.
Now, you mentioned that you have an 11-year-old. Do they understand what you do for a living?
Oh, absolutely. You know, I definitely have taught my daughter very young that this is a real world and you have to work, and not everybody gets to work 9 to 5, and that's okay. Doctors don't work 9 to 5. I mean, people in the service industry don't work 9 to 5, and it's not necessarily about the amount of time. It's more about the quality of the time that we spend together. And she has a good understanding of that.
Do you think she's going to go into automobile sales?
You know what? I'm not sure. I'm not sure. And if she does, I'll be here to support her.
It sounds like a plan.
Nikita, thank you. Oh, somebody else had something?
I was just going to ask one question in terms, because you refer to customers who come through the door, I guess to the dealership, as well as customers who basically come through the door after they've been online. From your perspective, which is the easier sell or which is the easier person to deal with?
You know, it's case by case, and it definitely depends on the person. I don't know that if I can necessarily categorize the sales easier than the sale, because it just depends. You know, you can have somebody that comes in, that walks in, you know, they look at like 30 different cars and then they're confused. And then you can have a person that negotiated everything online that comes in, and you know, the price is still not good enough. So it could go either way for either customer.
Okay.
Great. Nikita, I want to thank you for taking the time. Please feel free to come back.
Thank you for having me.
On the show, if there's something new on the horizon, wish you much, much success.
Thank you.
And I wish the Downey Nissan success. Tell your owner, I appreciate him allowing you to come
on. Thank you. No, he's the best. He really is. So thank you so much.
And you'll be able to watch the replay of this on YouTube. I'll send you a link.
Awesome. Thank you. You guys, nice meeting you all.
Take care.
Nice meeting you all. Have a good day. Take care.
Bye, you too.
You can log out. I don't know how. Okay. All right. That's interesting. Hey, maybe we can get some more salespeople on or some managers from dealerships, because it's always interesting to talk to people who are out there on the front line. You know, we talk to presidents and CEOs of car companies. We talk to engineers and designers. But it's hard to get somebody that's actually in a dealership to come on any program to talk about the industry, because they feel that they're going to be blasted. They're going to be treated negatively. And we don't do that on this show. We'll ask some tough questions, but we're not going to disrespect people for what they do and what they chose as a way to earn a living. Like we said earlier, you know, I've sold and leased cars. Didn't particularly like it, but I did it for 4.5 years and supported my family for 4.5 years until I decided to do something on my own. So, and it was on commission. So like Nikita said, you can make a pretty decent living selling anything on commission. What do you guys think about Nikita?
I think she's a very smart lady. And she's also playing in a field where it's a traditionally been a man's world. Yeah, I wish you nothing but good luck with it. And it's going to be tougher, especially with the push to more online stuff, you know, adapting your sales technique and how you service those customers going forward. And in addition with some of the new technology that's coming out, especially Nissan with their e-pedal driving, basically one pedal driving, that's going to take a different kind of salesperson than we normally expect.
Right. Yeah, the industry. Hey, Valerie. Valerie's on the phone.
She's muted, huh?
Yeah, the whole industry is changing. You know, we always talk about mobility, and we have been talking about mobility now for probably, I would say, over a year. And technology in cars, as we all know, have just gotten to the point where it's confusing to most people. And when before Linda left us, she would always talk about knobs. I want my knobs back. I want my knobs. I want things to be simple. I want my radio knob. And it's interesting. I read an article of, I forgot, one of the car companies now is going back to knobs.
Oh, Honda Acura.
Is it Acura?
Yeah, Honda Acura. One of their PR pro folks met with our local journalism group recently, and they said one of the things they learned is drivers still want to be able to tune the radio, turn it on and tune the radio. If nothing else, they can deal with the touch screen for everything else, but that radio is still a tactile expression, a tactile sensation they want to go through.
Well, you know, this morning on one of the morning shows, there was a report. There's a study out that basically rates different cars or different brands in terms of safety. in terms of, you know, as we've noted, that they're putting all this technology on cars, and the technology itself is so distracting that it becomes dangerous to involve yourself with it while you're driving. And they rated the brands in terms of who's the best and who's the worst. And some of the more expensive brands were actually the worst.
Right.
Because they've got the most technology. Because there's very, you know, as you say, in terms of knobs, there's very little you can do, you know, in a vehicle these days without touching the screen, doing this, doing that, having to, you know, look at what you're doing. If you're looking at a screen or a panel of controls, implicit in that is your eye is not on the road.
Right. What do you guys think about heads-up display? You know, more car companies now are adding heads-up display, and more information is being added to the heads-up display. How would you look at heads-up display versus a traditional nav screen?
I would probably recommend that, you know, you probably strip out a lot of the extraneous stuff from heads-up display, because you're driving down the road, you get the heads-up display with all this information in your foreground. You still got to look in the background to see what the heck's going on down the road. Watch, you know, peripheral vision. And so I don't need that much distraction. Maybe give me my speed or something, or give me an alert that you get an incoming phone call. But other than that, it can be somewhat of a distraction, especially on busy highways where there's a lot of other things going on. You know, it's like, whoa, how much information can I input through these set of eyes into this old brain and process at the right speed at the right time?
I agree in the sense that a heads-up display, again, takes your eye off the road, because although you're looking out at the windshield, you're trying to read something versus actually looking at the road. However, it's probably quicker in milliseconds or nanoseconds, whatever you want to call them, to refocus on the road. But again, in terms of what Greg is saying, I agree that a lot of the, you know, as these heads-up displays are getting bigger and having more information, I think it's even more distracting, you know, because beyond the speed, maybe you've got heads-up navigations in the heads-up display, that may be one thing, but really beyond the speed and a little bit, you know, I think they are just distracting.
All right. Hey, Valerie.
Hi, everybody.
From Austin, Texas.
Yeah, from Austin, Texas.
Latino reports.
Latino traffic report. Yes.
Traffic. Oh, Latino traffic reports.
That's right.
Go ahead, Valerie.
I was going to say, I remember the first head-up display I saw was on a General Motors, and I loved it. I thought, wow, that's so cool. I could keep my eyes focused, and it worked really well. It was easy to find the knob for adjusting the view, because obviously it was harder for me to see it. But since then I've been in so many different versions of it that I could see how it is distracting. I actually was just in the Mazda 3, and they have that little plastic shield that pokes up. That one I thought was the most distracting so far. I like having that information in front of me though, and I'm loving that more and more, including speed limit information. That helps a lot. But I could see how it's a, you know, like it or love it kind of situation. I think it's always good to have more information, but so long as it doesn't distract you from where you're going.
The downside for me with heads-up display is the screen adjustment, placing the location of the screen where you can actually see it. It used to be a couple of buttons right there next to the heads-up display that you could adjust up, down, left, right. Now on some cars, you have to go into a different program, find the heads-up display, and then make the adjustment. So,
right. The GM version was the easiest because it had that little button that said HUD to the left of the steering wheel, and I could figure that out simply. But on the Mazda, I actually had to ask how to find it. And you're right. You have to go into the infotainment system and look in the settings, and you can't do – I mean, don't do that driving. I don't think you can do it driving. So – yeah, you're right that it's getting a little more complicated.
Well, Nissan introduced us to Roby the robot. I don't know whether you saw the article or the video. And the question was, how many times in a year do you open and close the door? of a car? Well, they actually built a robot that they call Robbie. And it's 45,000 times the door is opened and closed. So they have this Robbie the robot that does this. And in 3 days, the robot can accomplish 45,000 opening and closings of a door. And they made it a point to say that Robbie does not take breaks, coffee breaks, smoking breaks, or whatever. So Robbie is constantly working. How many jobs did Robbie take?
Well, you know, the footman that I used to have and the chauffeur, I mean, I had to let them go when I got that technology going. I mean, I just didn't need them anymore.
Right. Well, we had a quick show. Valerie, you should have been on earlier. We had Nikita Yashi on talking about sales, females on the sales floor. She's a very, very successful general sales manager from Downey Nissan out in Los Angeles.
I was watching.
Oh, you were? Okay. Mm-hmm. I want to thank her for taking the time to come on the show. We'd like to have more people from the dealership side to come on. We won't hurt you. We won't abuse you. We just want good information for our viewers and listeners. So that's it. Quick 30 minutes. I want to thank everybody for taking the time, especially the panelists from their busy schedule and you watching the live portion as well as the on-demand replay. You can catch us on Facebook. You can catch us on the YouTube channel, autonetwork.com. And as always, please buckle up. Don't drink and drive. Please buckle up. Don't text and drive. See you next time.
Okay. Bye, everybody.
Bye.
Be safe.
Have a nice Thanksgiving.
Oh, thanks. Same to you.
Thanks to you. Same to you.
Bye.